X, which is compact, you know? And we have your plus of X is minus infinity, and this implies that phi 1 of X is a trivial, or we have kappa plus of X is greater or equal to 0. This implies that if pi of OX is 0, then we have the inequality kappa plus of X is greater or equal to gamma D of X. This is this is the comparison theorem. So the proof, I have not introduced the two invariants, kappa plus and gamma d of x. So let me recall now what was first for kappa plus of x. Recall its definition. This is the maximum of all the kappa of x, and then we have take determinant of f, okay, for any f, any p positive, and any f which is included in omega p of x. Okay, so we take all these subshapes which are here, we take the determinant. Actually, I will not go into this, but we have maybe to take the saturation, but I don't speak about this. The saturation. And so we compute this, and this is the maximum. As we have seen this, we have in general kappa plus of x. This is greater than or equal to kappa of x, which is by definition kappa of x and kx, the canonical bundle. And so recall a little bit. This is not difficult to show, that if x is rationally connected, then this implies that kappa plus of x is minus infinity. We have a one prime, a relative version. If we have x, f, let us take directly, or which is x to r x. So here, the fibers are rationally connected, and this is not linear. So there is this. So Misha calls it the MRC. This is the Collard and other terminology. I call it the rational quotient. But, so this is just a question of terminology. So we have this. Then if this is, let me call it the rational quotient. Rational quotient, then we have, this is not a difficult, this is a relative version of this. And kappa plus of x is plus of Rx. So you have the base here, which is not uniroule. So conjecturally, at least, it has kappa greater than or equal to 0. And so you have the same kappa plus here and there. This is a very simple to imagine. The thing you may have in the special case you may have in head is the following. You take x is pk across some z here, which is of dimension n minus k, and here this is of dimension n, for example. And if we assume that this has kappa greater than or equal to 0, so then all the sheaves that you may have here and which have a positive determinant with the sections, they have to come from here. They come from the base, actually. And so this explains this reason. Because on the fibers here, from the base, of the base being the n minus k here. So because along these projective spaces, you have no holomorphic forms at all, and no tensor, in omega n. Excuse me? Is what? Yes. I wanted to state this. This is a theorem. This is the only case where we have a theorem.
have this.
We have this rational quotient. So the other situation is when we have C1 of X is zero, and this implies, we have seen it, that kappa plus of X is zero, which is the same. And this implies actually that we have kappa of X is zero. But now, if we have kappa of X is zero, then this is a completely open question to know whether kappa plus of X is zero. And so this is a conjecture. This is a conjecture one. Let me explain you what it means. Even a very special case of this conjecture, which is open. An example, this is Veno's conjecture. One, I don't know if there are others. Veno's conjecture. Assume that you have kappa of X is zero. Does this imply that we have H zero of X omega P of X is less or equal to N P or P equal to zero? So we have this. So this is Veno's conjecture. And why is this a special case of this? You see, this NP, this is XN, of course. This is the dimension here. And so this is just the rank. So assume that you have that this inequality is violated. So this means that inside of omega p, for example, you have a subshape of rank r with at least r plus one sections. And if you take the determinants, you can choose in two ways, linearly independent sections. You take r and you take another set of r sections, and this gives you two linearly independent sections in the determinant of this sheaf. And so this gives you this, which shows that the kappa of this determinant will be at least one, and not zero. So this is a special case. Special case of the conjecture one. And this result is known only actually when P is one for holomorphic one forms. Just because it says you, in this case, you know that the Albanese map is a higher result of color. So this is just to explain you what is a little bit, some special case to understand what it means. And so now I will say just now the conjecture two. Ah, this is the conjecture one. Conjecture one, this implies, in fact, that kappa of X is greater than or equal to zero, implies kappa plus of X is equal to kappa of X. So in this case, we should have just nothing better like this. And the only situation when we have this is in the extremal case. So we have three, if kappa of X, kappa plus of X is N. If kappa plus of X is N, a priori, you know only that kappa of X is smaller. Then this could take, a priori, all possible values from N to minus infinity. But this implies in this situation that we have kappa of X is N. And so this is a result that results from a more general, this is a very special case of a more general state. And I will speak in detail next week on this thing. I think this is essential, yes. So the general situation is when the conjecture one plus conjecture two. Conjecture two is that X kappa of X is minus infinity implies X mu. So this is a conjecture. If this conjecture two, if we put them together, this one, this implies actually that we have a converse to this. This conjecture implies also one has to work again with this map. Where is it? With this map here. its map. This implies then kappa plus of x is minus infinity, implies x is partially connected. So you have this result. And so this implies also both conjecture. They also implies, in general, they give a complete description of what is kappa plus, what should be a kappa plus. Kappa plus of x, this is nothing else than kappa of r x here. With kappa of 1 point, this convention is minus infinity. So you have this result, so we say yes. Go to this description. So now for gamma d. Let me motivate the construction by Shafarevitz conjecture. Actually, this was not my original motivation, but so the Shafarevitz conjecture of Shafarevitz. Is the following. This is x tilde, we call it pi x. So this is the universal cover. This, if let x tilde be the universal cover, then x tilde should be holomorphic. This is a notion from function theory. This quite classical, and so this can be also presented in a following way, which means that there exists maybe could be x tilde to some s tilde, where this is Stein, it's a normal space, and this is a proper. Connected map means with connected fibers. So this means that you should have this simple description. So we take two extreme cases. The first case is when x tilde is compact. So in this case, s tilde is just 1 point. And the other extreme case is when x tilde is s tilde. So this means x tilde is Stein. In particular, that does not contain compact subsets of positive dimension. And so this means that here, if you are in this situation, this means then that all your compact analytic, the compact analytic sub-varieties, irreducible, are contained in the fibers of this map, and that the fibers of this map are actually the maximal, the maximal such sub-varieties. It means this, because here in a Stein space, you don't have any compact analytic subset except for points, irreducible. So, and now we have a very weak approximation of this result. And so we have a theorem. There exists. Actually, the theorem I will state, so Shafarevitz said this for projective manifold, but we extend it to Keller, the Keller case. And also, Shafarevitz conjecture is only for the universal cover. But here, this result is actually also true for any cover. There exists actually an x tilde, to maybe I will call it gamma tilde x, some s tilde x here, which possesses the following property. Which is proper, holomorphic, of course. Here I'm cheating very slightly, but almost not. This actually is a little bit meromorphic, but this meromorphy is concentrated on a really non-important subset. So I state it as it is with a holomorphic. This is a proper map, proper, such that this is uniquely defined, actually, such that we have. For any V tilde in R. For any S tilde belonging to S tilde general. This is not as good as this one. General, this means outside of a countable union of closed proper subsets. So this is the meaning of a general. Kodaira, I used it since a very, very long time. Kodaira used it very general. This very is completely useless because you have already the difference between generic and general. So if foundational people in the algebraic geometry used generic, so you can use a general or whatever. So, this is what I was saying. This is a Kodaira introduced this, and I say that this is useless to use to add a vary. Kodaira comes 10 years or 15 years later, and so he uses another terminology. But because he writes books and books, people use his terminology. Because sometimes people are confused and really they use general in the sense of generic. And so if you write a general, they say, oh, you mean generic. I have had already this. So general, so we, for any of this and for any V tilde, which is analytic, compact, irreducible, meeting x tilde s tilde, which is just gamma x tilde minus 1 s tilde. So this is the fiber over the point. This is the fiber. So you take an analytic, irreducible compact subset. Maybe this is better to make drawings. So we have this S tilde, so we have X tilde, and here we have this fiber. X tilde, S tilde here. And if you take something which is a compact analytic, so this is the V tilde here, then this is forbidden. If it is compact, it has to be contained in the fiber. Implies for any V, this implies that V tilde is contained in S tilde, S tilde. So this is the meaning. So this is exactly what would happen here, except that in this case, you have this for any S tilde instead of just the general one. So there is a bad subset here where we don't know, where things can degenerate, but remaining inside also something. There is also kind of a saturated bad subset, but it is a saturated point. You can't go outside if you start from this with a compact analytic subset. So you have this property. So what is missing is here that it is not known whether one can remove this, and we have absolutely no idea of what S tilde is with respect to. In general, we don't know the existence even of a single holomorphic function. So this is a much weaker situation. But then this implies S tilde, this is a certain space. There exists a space on X. On X. It depends on X. Alone. On X alone. Yes. It is determined. It's essentially, what is it? This is essentially the Shaw Barlet scheme of. X tilde parameterizing the largest possible compact subset. You have such a scheme. When I say scheme, this is analytic space, countable at infinity. From S tilde to X? No. But you will see what is existing. We don't know anything, nothing. even in the case, surface case, for example. You see, the first case, you take a surface and you assume that its universal cover is really large, so that it doesn't contain any compact analytic subset. For example, we don't know how to construct even a single holomorphic function on the universal cover. Excuse me? Some? On X? Keller, compact Keller. But this is essential. X, yes, X is always for compact Keller. This is false, completely false for, if you take a non-compact object, even I think if you take, okay, I have to think to really to find a counterexample, but I think there are lots of counterexamples. Because this is really a kind of compactness of a show scheme of manifold, but here you have to work on this in a non-compact. And so this means now, because you have, of course, this uniqueness of this thing, this means that this map actually is descends to a quotient. This is a pi 1 of x equivalent. By a pi 1 equivalence, this implies now that there exists actually a map x here from Sx. Let me call it gamma x here. Then there exists also such a map. And here, this is just x tilde modulo pi 1 of x, and this is here s tilde x divided by pi 1 of x. You can let pi 1 of x act because this thing is pi 1 of x equivalent. So you have such a map, which is, which descends to this, and with the following property, which is characterized actually by the following property. For any s in S, X, general again, general. You have, if you, and for any V inside of X, a compact analytic, yes, a compact analytic, irreducible. Maybe I have forgotten to say compact ions, irreducible. You couldn't. Instead of the irreducible, you could take a connected here. This would also be true. Because if you have it for irreducible, then you can do this by chain. So compact analytic, but here irreducible is better. And such that if pi 1, if V means XS, which has the same meaning, so this is the fiber of this gamma x over s, then we have the equivalence between the two properties. Pi 1 of v hat x is finite. It's equivalent. Say that v is contained in xs. And I should explain what is this thing. This is the image. This is the image of pi 1. V had pi 1 of x, and V had, this is the normalization. So we have this property. So you can try to think a little bit to make the change, but you have exactly this, this property. Now, I should add here that this this map was constructed for X projected independently around the same time. So you have this result. And so now we can say what is the dimension, the definition. Gamma d of x, by definition, this is just, this is the dimension of x. So
If you prefer to say this, yes, I would like to say remark if that is that these the fibers here, the generic fibers are smooth, in particular. So these manifolds which are maximally with finite pi one here inside of pi one of x, they are smooth. So this is a very good. Gamali, this is here. And now we have the following properties. So we have the, which is essentially obvious, is gamma d of x is zero. Ah, maybe I should say. Of course, gamma d of x is greater or equal to zero, less or equal to n. And we have gamma d of x is zero. This is equivalent to say that pi one of x is some obvious reason, because here this means that this, if this is zero, so this means that here the fibers, which is pi one of x, it has a finite image into itself. So it is finite. Now two some remarks. Ah yes. So this gamma d of x, this is birational. Birational, this is fairly clear, and etal, this is also, this is obvious, these are two obvious properties. You see, because if you take a finite cover, then you get the same thing, and the properness is a, you have the same universal cover, actually. Free, I don't forget to say. Let me take n is one, the case of curves. So we you have two cases, g is zero, and this implies that gamma d is zero, or you have g greater than one, that implies gamma d is one. Okay? Because for elliptic curves, the universal cover is C, and for hyperbolic curves, the universal cover is the unit disk. But for curves, nothing happened. For n equal to, I let you to do this as an exercise if you want. When kappa is minus infinity, this is easy. 0, 1, for example. For kappa is 2, then you have all the possibilities. Gamma d is 0, 1, 2 are possible. This is easy to make examples. You can. This is easy to make examples. Five. Yes. Now a property. We know that if x is rationally connected, this implies that pi one of x is one, and this implies certainly that gamma d of x is zero. So in general, we have six. If we take now this. Rational quotient of MRC quotient here, if we have R of X, when we have pi one of X, this is pi one of Rx. You see, this is very similar to what happens actually, this gamma D, very similar to what happens for kappa plus. We have something similar. If we have something, this is isomorphic, and then it is very easy also to see that gamma D of X, this is gamma D. Or x. So this doesn't change when we take the if this is the rational quotient. No, maybe I will take another example. This is similar to the case of the elliptic curve. If x is abelian variety or a complex torus. And we have d of x is n, just because the universal cover is cn. So this is a simple example. Yes, this is in general very complicated to compute this. But six, I will maybe notice that in general, two things. what is the fibers of gamma x maybe they have large fundamental group. Large fundamental group and be of general type. This is not difficult to see. Let me give a very, very simple example. Take, for example, y, which is P2 cross A, where this is abelian. Variety, for example, and then what you can take and take X, this is a hyperplane section, smooth hyperplane section, type, I mean, of by degree, you have dH, and here you have some HA. You can just take, for ample line bundle here, you take something which has a degree D on P2, and something which is ample here, and so you take a hyperplane section, a smooth hyperplane section here. This is taking this sufficiently ample, and where D is greater than 4, and we have a fibration X goes to A, which is onto, and here the fibers are curves of degree D, O, P2 of D, excuse me, of degree D on P2. And if we take a D greater than in 4, this implies that CG is greater than or equal to 2. This is just a D minus 1, D minus 2 divided by 2. And so this means that you should not, one should not, can't expect that the fibers here have a small fundamental group. But the fundamental group can be very large and also obvious. So this is by Lefschetz's hyperplane section. Yes, and another thing one should notice also that in general, you don't have gamma d of Sx is smaller than the dimension of Sx. Yes, because a thing you might happen is because essentially all the fundamental group of pi 1 of x comes from Sx. You might expect that the gamma d of x is big also, but the pi 1 of Sx can be very small, it can be trivial. And so this is just because the right notion of this, right notion, is not Sx to this, it's not Sx, but manifold. Gamma x, which goes from x to Sx here. So, and this orbifold base, this will be Sx, and here we will have something which I call delta of gamma x here, because in general, so you need maybe to make some modifications, blow ups and so on, both on Sx and on x, and so you can get here. This will be a divisor with some multiplicities, which encodes the multiplicities over the fibers of gamma x. I don't give the details, but the important fact is that you will have, in general, pi 1 of xs here, you have an exact sequence of groups here, pi 1 of x, and here you get to pi 1. This is the orbifold fundamental group to sx and delta gamma x. And here you have one. And here, this is the right object actually to consider. And this, in general, this fundamental group, so you have a surjective map from Sx, but here you may have a very big kernel. The kernel here, which is generated by torsion elements, but which may be infinite and very large. You have the simplest example is maybe if you take P1, and if you take maybe three or more points with certain multiplicities, then in general you get this is uniformized by a curve of a big genus. If you take large multiplicities on these three points, three or more points. So this is the right object to consider. And there is a whole theory to be developed here, which is developed to a certain extent. So you have also orbifold fundamental groups, but also universal covers and so on, which you can define this situation. Go into this. So now let me give some remark. Remark. So we had the kappa plus of x is minus infinity, and this implies that pi 1 of x, that this is trivial. So one way you may have it is x is rationally connected. So we know in this case by direct geometric argument that we have pi 1 of this, and this implies this. Now, so conjecturally, this. So this result is not very surprising, but there are two possibilities. Either this conjecture is true, and then the theorem is not stronger than this implication, once you have shown the equivalence, of course, which is quite difficult. Or the conjecture is false, which I don't believe, actually, is false, and then this means that they are non-rationally connected, having this property. And then the theorem is stronger than this implication plus the. Now, some an interesting case is this. Now, this comparison theorem, the interesting case, excuse me, this is non-zero. Sorry, this is very important. This is non-zero. Maybe I should make another remark. So if you know that this is a small, for example, particularly interesting case in when this is zero, so because this implies when the fundamental group is finite. And so the corollary is this. Before I do this, another remark. If chi of Ox is zero, then this inequality. The star is this inequality. This is false. And a very simple example is the following. Take x is a n, this is an abelian. Relative, and for it you have chi of O a n, this is zero, but we have gamma d of x. And so, the inequality is maximally violated. So you have the smallest possible kappa plus. Oh yes, abelian. I have forgotten. And we have kappa plus of the n. So you have kappa plus of a n is zero, but nevertheless you have a gamma d which is very big. And essentially, this should be the main counterexample, and maybe. In some sense, if you have violation of this inequality, probably you should have, maybe after a finite little cover, some abelian variety which comes in. But the proof actually of the theorem can't be in this case. And corollary, now if kappa plus of x is zero, and if we have chi of Ox is non-zero, and we have an inequality. Then we know that the fundamental group is finite, but we have better because we can bound its order. Pi 1 of x, it's a cardinality. This is its cardinality. This is less than or equal to 2 minus 1 divided by the absolute value of chi of Ox. let me explain why is it so. Indeed, we know that the universal cover is compact. So we take the universal cover of X, and here you have pi. And so we know that, and this is d to 1, where d, this is the cardinality of pi 1 of x. And so we have chi of ox tilde with a multiplicativity of chi. This is chi of ox d times. And here, now, this quantity, chi of ox tilde, this is certainly less than 2 power n minus 1 here. Just because kappa plus of x is 0, this implies precisely then that h 0 of x, and this is we know inequality, omega q of x, this is less than or equal to n q or any q greater than or equal to 0. And so the only the maximal thing that you can have, so you have, you have chi of ox. This is the sum of the thing from q is 0 to n and even. So you have this h 0 of x, the q of x, and you have the minus for q is 1 to n and odd. Here for this H0 of the same thing here. And so this means the way this, only way this can be maximal is when all of these are here and everything here vanishes. And if you take the absolute value, then you can reverse the thing. And so this is the sum, because the sum here, this is equal to 2 times n minus 1, and this is also equal to n minus 1. You have this bound. You can bound the order of the fundamental group by this, by using this multiplicativity. Yeah, of this, and what I want, an example of this. Example, if A of X is 0, and I of OX is non-zero, then you have this inequality. And A of X is 0, this means that you don't have any meromorphic function on your manifold. Non-constant meromorphic function. This is a case which is very opposite to the projective case. And another thing is if the dimension of X is n is equal to 3, then we can check this property actually. We have if A of X is 0, A of X is 0, this implies immediately kappa plus of X is 0, is less than 1. Yes, is it clear? Because if you have a rank, if you have a sheaf F of rank R, you can't have more than R sections. Otherwise, you can produce a non-constant meromorphic function. So this property implies, so we have this property. If A of X is 0, and if Q is 0, then this implies now that chi of OX is non-zero. This is positive. This is positive. And we have also, and we have in this case a little bit better, pi 1 of X is less than or equal to 3. We have at most 3 elements. And let me explain why we have this property. So we can, instead of having 4 here, we have 3. We can exclude 4. You can do this as an exercise. Why do we have this? Because we have chi of OX. Now this is 1 minus Q plus H20 and minus H30. Here, if we have A of X is 0, this is less than or equal to 1, because it has rank 1, otherwise you have a non-constant meromorphic function. And here, EQ is 0, so you have this. So you have, this is certainly greater than or equal to H2 zero of X here. And now we have Kodaira's theorem. Says that X is non-projective, then H2 zero of X Keller. The Keller assumption is still needed. H2 zero of X is strictly positive. You have necessarily a holomorphic, at least one holomorphic to form. So in this case, you can just check it. If you have A of X, you just have. So either you have an Albanese map or you have finite fundamental. Now we can go to the proof of the proof of theorem. And so here we will not have time to say much, but I will only say you will see the proof of theorem. So this rests on L2 methods. Actually, the proof is very close to proof of Gromov of the special case. So, what was missing in fact in Gromov text was the existence of this. So the first step is to produce. So the first step is theorem, which is due to Atiyah, and this is just a special case, Atiyah, and which says the following: that chi of OX, this is L2, chi of X tilde. X tilde, this is the universal cover. So the theorem of Atiyah is much more general. And here, what is this? This is, so we assume that X is equipped with a Keller metric, and that we lift this Keller metric to X tilde. So we get also a Keller metric on X tilde, which is periodic, invariant by pi 1. I will, to simplify it, pi 1 of X. And so this is here, this is actually the alternating sum of minus 1 Q, and here we have the H. What is H zero Q of X here, or Q zero N? So dimension Q, and these are here the harmonic forms of type zero Q on X. Here, this is the same thing, but the minus one Q. Same thing, it's minus 1, 2, and here I have the dimension. This is the gamma dimension of H2, 0, 2 on X tilde. I will write X. And so this is by definition, so this is exactly what the definition of this, and this is the definition of this. I will say what is this gamma dimension. At least it give a very short definition of what it is. This L2, what did I want? So, and Atiyah's theorem is the existence of this. He has actually a proof in a much more general situation for elliptic operators, even in the smooth case. But what is the dimension? If we have H, this is a Hilbert space. Which gamma acts unitarily. This will be the case here. Observe unitarily. Yes. And the gamma dimension of H. This can be defined. For example, this is one possible definition. This will be the integral over X of, say, f of X, and we take volume corresponding to the Keller metric here, to this volume, and we assume that this is normalized in such a way that volume of X is 1. Actually, Atiyah doesn't say this, but we see you have to take this normalization. And so you have this where we define first f tilde of x tilde, on x tilde as follows. We take, let S n, this is an orthonormal basis of H. And when we define on x tilde, we have the function f tilde of x tilde, which is just defined by the sum over n here of S alpha. You have a norm here squared. And here you take this, and this function, this is gamma invariant. This f tilde of x tilde, so this is of the form f tilde of u. This is of the form f tilde, phi tilde of f. So this defines, so this is the definition of f. F, and once you have f, then you can define this, and this is the gamma dimension. So this is the first case. Then the corollary is this. So pi of Ox is non-zero, and there exists Q positive, such that H02 non-zero. So there is now a holomorphic Q form, which is L2 on X tilde for this invariant metric, and which is non-zero. And so the reason is very simple. So you take this gamma dimension raising. You take now this, so you know that this is non-zero. So this is non-zero, so there is here a certain Q, such that this is non-zero. Yes, this is H0 Q of X tilde 2 is non-zero. So if we, let me call it maybe S bar. And then by conjugation, you get S bar R. Let me call it S here. This belongs to this element for some Q. And so you have to show that Q is strictly positive. This is just for a simple reason. I maybe I have no time to give the details. For Q strictly positive, then if you have H0 of X tilde or X tilde, this is zero. Excuse me. This is zero. At least I am implicitly assuming. This is here if I one of x is infinite. If, we need this assumption. If I one of x is infinite, just because if you have a holomorphic function which is L2, then it has to go to zero at infinity. This is essentially because locally you have L2 norm is greatly larger than the infinity norm. If you have a small compact subset, then on this you can bound from above the uniform norm by the L2. So otherwise, if it doesn't go to zero at infinity, you take a sequence of points, you get their projection, you can assume that they go to converge to a certain point in the neighborhood of the, this point, you can choose a small compact subset which contains an open neighborhood, and in which you have this. And if they don't go to zero, this is bounded from below by something, and so you would get an infinite L2 norm for your function. So this is easy. It's an easy argument. Once you have this, just this comparison thing.
of if maybe I will just try to show that if, because this is kappa plus of x is minus infinity, this implies that pi 1 of x is 1. Because the proof can be simplified in this case. Yes. So what we have, so we start with this S, which is non-zero, and which is below. So what are we going to do? So let us assume, for simplicity, otherwise I will say, for simplicity, the gamma star of S, this is proportion to S for any gamma in one of x. So if you don't have this, what are you going to do? You are going to define pi 1 of x invariant subchief in omega q of x tilde just by considering the subchief which is generated by all possible gamma s. So because you are in omega q which has a finite dimension, so this will generate at each point you get a certain subsheaf. This subsheaf will be invariant. It descends to below, and so this gives will be give sheaf here in this. And so instead of this, we will be, instead of considering S, we will then replace S will be replaced by S gamma two will be star. S and so gamma star of S, we choose gamma 2, gamma r here in such a way that it generates at least the sheaf f tilde at the generic point. We replace this, and this explains that we will get a determinant of some f with some f which is in omega q. This explains why we will. But just I do this here, this not, this doesn't make a big difference. Replacing or proportional, so and now I replace S if needed by S power 2, which is a section. Now we get 2 omega 2 or x. Oh, maybe it's not the best thing to do. No. Okay. By 2, and this now, this becomes an L1 section of. I take f, this is just the sheaf which is generated by f tilde, and so it depends, and this is of the form f. Maybe in this case, this will be a line bundle. And this will be a line bundle, and so we take this s here, and I take s2, this will be a section of l tilde. So this will become L1. And so why is it interesting? Now I consider sigma, this is S2 rather, and this is L1. Now this implies that sigma tensor M here, this will be a section. This is a section of L2 times M L tilde is for any M positive, but what if, and this will be also L1. And so this implies that now we can consider sigma tensorized M with bar, and this will be the sum over gamma of gamma star of sigma tensorized with M here. So we will get all these sections here, and which are of the form pi star of certain. I should call it pi star of 2m here, where 2m, this is a section of L times m here. So we have this, we get all these sections.
And now this means that we have another section, another section is just sigma bar here, and here you can take the tensorized with M. Now, X into X, the generic, such that we have S of X is non-zero, for example. And what will happen, we use the following lemma. Lemma is that if AN, if this is a sequence, an L1 sequence of complex number, such that sigma of A and N is zero. One needs in general slightly more general forms for any M positive, and this implies that A N is zero. Here. And now, what can we do? So the conclusion, if we apply this, sigma tensorized M with M, we evaluate at A, evaluate at X things here. If X is zero for any M positive, then we get that sigma, then we get then that S of X, yes, and that S of, yes, that S of gamma X is zero for any gamma. And this contradicts, of course, this fact. But here, this contradicts this fact, but here we are in the situation where we assume that this, so this means if, because S is non-zero, this implies that there exists an M positive, such that sigma tensorized M, this is non-zero. But, and so this implies that there exists a section, this implies that tau M, which belongs to H0 now of X, and here, this is L tensorized 2 times M here. And recall that L is included in omega Q of X here. And that this is non-zero. And now this contradicts kappa plus of X is minus infinity. So what happened? What happens? Where is the contradiction? The contradiction is that when this implied, because in order to get this S, this section S, which was non-zero, we made the assumption that pi 1 of X was infinite. So the conclusion is that pi 1 of X is finite. Pi 1 of X is finite. And this implies now that pi 1 of X is 1. This is, I will not do this, but this is just, you use again, the fact that you have X tilde, yes, I will do this. So this is D to 1, so this is the universal cover, and now this is a finite here. And again, we have key of OX tilde, this is D times key OX. And where is the problem? Problem now, but probably this is completely stupid. I don't refine the argument again. So, so if we have kappa plus of X is zero, notice that kappa plus of X is minus infinity. This implies, in particular, that H0 of X omega Q of X, that this is zero for any Q positive. And this implies that chi of OX is 1. Here is 1. And so you have to show the same thing. Then this implies then that kappa plus of X tilde is minus infinity. But here, I don't find again the argument for this. And this would probably, I don't understand. This is completely stupid. And here you have, again, chi of O x tilde, this has to be 1 again. And so, because the two differ by a proportionality factor of B, and this implies that B is 1. So I don't remember. So this is not so important. And maybe just some words, just to say, yes. Just in general, if one generalizes a little bit this argument here, one needs a little bit stronger lemma. Where was this lemma? Lemma, here. So you have to compare, if you have two such sequences, and if the sum coincide, then the AN has to be equal to the BN up to permutation. So this is this, and so this permits to show the following. If we have X, we have two things. We go to some Z, which is just the phi, which is defined by the linear system. System maybe M determinant of F tensorized for M, or M very big and divisible. So you have, and so this means that this will be kappa of X determinant of F. This will be the dimension. The dimension of C. So we have this phi M. And here we have, on the other hand, we have the gamma thing. And so what you construct, you show that the fibers of this map here, when you take their inverse image in the universal cover, the irreducible compact components have to be compact. And so you have a factorization map, which gives you that the dimension of this is greater than the dimension of this. And this is by dimension. By definition, this is gamma d of x, and so you get the inequality. So, very sloppy. Sorry for